Agnieszka Brugger is the deputy chair of the parliamentary Green Party in the German Bundestag. She's an expert on defense policy, and her vision is for a world without nuclear weapons. Agnieszka Brugger, welcome to the DW interview.
Hello.
Ms. Brugger, US President Donald Trump is planning to scrap the nuclear arms deal with Iran, which would allow Tehran to carry on building the bomb. North Korea already has nuclear missiles. Does it frustrate you to see your vision of a nuclear-free world disappearing?
It's an extremely dangerous situation, clearly. The concern that Iran could soon have a nuclear weapons program at its disposal and become one more nuclear power instead of us moving towards a nuclear-free world was justified. Of course, there's always a risk that agreements may be breached or sidestepped, but this particular deal guarantees scrutiny in a way we couldn't have without it. It's imperative that we keep this deal. For me, it's one of the diplomatic success stories of recent years. Angela Merkel has to do all she can now to convince Donald Trump not to break off the deal, as that would be playing with fire.
French President Emmanuel Macron said he believes the US president really will scrap the deal. This is the reality we have to face. At the age of 33, one could describe you as a grandchild of the peace movement. You keep a critical distance to the military and armament. What makes you so keen to get involved with the German army?
I wanted to join the Defense Committee when I was first elected in 2009, as these questions of war and peace are incredibly important to me. If there is no peace in the world, or people have to live in fear of violence, then we might as well forget about other debates on the world's great challenges. For me, it was never just the fascination of whether there should be military intervention, yes or no. There are nuances to this question, and then the question is, what happens next?
You want to abolish nuclear weapons, the army too?
No, a world where we could all settle our disputes with reasoned arguments and reach workable solutions together is, of course, a wonderful vision, one we should always have in mind. But the reality is clearly far removed from this. As we observe in many regions of the world, the lack of statehood and order is a root cause of violence, a reason to join terrorist groups. In my view, under certain conditions, there are scenarios in which the deployment of the German army with a UN mandate can be absolutely the right thing to do.
The German army is currently deployed in many overseas missions. In Syria and in Iraq, the German army supplies reconnaissance data regarding Islamic State and is also involved in combat. Do you believe these missions are justified?
In the Bundestag, the Green Party has always opposed these missions while making it clear that we believe the terrorism of the so-called Islamic State has to be fought using military means but can only be defeated politically. We have a number of issues with the missions. One is whether they are founded on international law, and another is that the German army is not deployed within a collective security system such as the United Nations or European Union, but in a coalition of the willing, which is characterized by highly contradictory interests. A further issue is the danger of what happens if the reconnaissance data is used by Turkey, for example, in the fight against the Kurds. The federal government has not given us any convincing answers as to how this can be avoided, so we decided against the missions.
But if I understand you correctly, the fight is legitimate, because IS is responsible for murder, pillage, kidnappings, rape, and enslaving women. And such a barbaric enemy has to be met with force.
If we think of the horrendous case, for example, where the Yazidi were trapped in the mountains, military intervention by the USA led to their release. So I would say in this instance that military action can't be condemned in general. But before I agree to such a mission, it has to be founded in international law, and one must feel that in the end there will be less violence. Currently, there are many problems with military intervention.
It's difficult to move the UN Security Council to take unanimous action due to conflicting political interests. Is a deployment, such as that of the USA, France and Britain to attack Assad's chemical weapons, sometimes legitimate, if not legal?
Of course, it cannot be tolerated that Assad keeps using chemical weapons in this barbaric fashion in Syria. It's also a huge breach of international law. This is totally unacceptable. However, I don't think that retaliation with bombings outside the limits of international law is the cleverest reaction. This is not a step which brings us closer to a solution. It leads to further escalation. I believe that all states should now prioritize their endeavor to seek political solutions within the framework of the UN to put an end to the suffering of the civilian population.
Yet while others are talking, the Russian president is taking swift action in Syria and, to put it bluntly, bombing Assad back into power. Isn't that the sad reality?
It is the sad reality in Syria, and many mistakes have been made by various parties in the past. Of course, pressure has to be exerted on Russia. They are the one political power which is able to stop Assad.
In the Security Council, however, we see that President Putin is impervious to this. Instead of dialogue and cooperation, doesn't his rule apply? The more I use ruthless violence, the more I win politically and on the ground.
Unfortunately, men such as Turkey's President Erdogan, Vladimir Putin, and regrettably also Donald Trump are currently in the process of destroying a world peace that took us so long to build after two world wars with precisely this logic. The more I break the rules, the more military might I show, the more I can serve my own purposes.
But that's the case.
Yes, but in the end, it's very short-term thinking. Tearing up this rule book helps nobody. For me, it is the European states and international law which have to be the voice of reason in a world of Trump, Putin and Erdogan. No one, not even these three presidents, want to live in such disorder.
At the moment, there's also the issue of equipping the Bundeswehr to face aggressors. Do you approve of this?
We scrutinize the army very closely, and there are also huge problems. Procurement decisions affecting our soldiers deployed overseas should have a much higher priority. For example, with helicopters and uniforms, there have been huge problems for years. I'm already skeptical when we're now told we have to massively ramp up our equipment and expenditure to reach NATO's 2% target. I think we are playing a dangerous escalation game, where one side is always trying to keep up with the other. And in the end, we will have less, not more, security for everyone.
Defense Secretary Ursula von der Leyen wants to start a drone program for reconnaissance purposes. Is this also part of the escalation?
We Greens have always supported the army having reconnaissance drones, as used in Mali, for example, to contribute to United Nations missions. They are essential for seeing who is actually sticking to the peace agreement and who isn't. We in the Green Party have a big problem with the fact that combat drones are now being procured, which is what Ursula von der Leyen, the Defense Secretary, is now planning. So far, she hasn't presented a single convincing scenario where she would need and deploy them. Of course, we are observing worldwide that international law is being contravened with these weapons. These, of course, are worrying developments and have led to an intense debate here in Germany.
You don't just want to argue about political decisions, you want to make them yourself. You had the chance of joining a coalition with the defense minister and her Christian Democrats, along with the liberals. Do you regret that this chance was lost?
It's a real pity that the Greens are back in opposition, although the combination of those four parties, with hugely differing priorities, certainly would not have been easy for all concerned, as initial talks showed. Yet in spite of our differences regarding foreign and security policies, Ms. von der Leyen and I always said it wasn't our fault that the talks failed. We could have reached an agreement on common projects. It really is a pity that the FDP simply threw in the towel at the 11th hour and refused to take responsibility.
Dass die FDP da im letzten Moment einfach hingeworfen hat und sich der Verantwortung verweigert hat.
In 2009, you were elected to the Bundestag as a very young member. You were the youngest female representative and perhaps the most striking. You got a lot of attention. Was that a drawback?
Of course, every politician likes attention. The key is to shift the focus from appearance to content and to divert the attention. I was pleased when these portraits of me focusing on my hair color and piercings quickly receded, and it was much more about what came out of my mouth and not whether it's pierced.
When you joined the Bundestag, you said you wanted to live a green life. You don't drive and you've never flown. Have you been able to stick to that?
I'm afraid not. If you're involved in international politics, you can't really avoid flying. Someone read about my intentions and as a joke sent me a train timetable for my first trip to Afghanistan. That would have been a 5-day journey, and I don't know if it would have been to the right Kabul. Well, it just isn't feasible. Of course, I try to live in a way that matches my political convictions, but I'm also a pragmatic person. And in most cases, I pay the atmosphere at least to mitigate the damage caused to the climate.
Ms. Brugger, we've reached our final three questions. Please complete these sentences. That peace can sometimes only be achieved through armed struggle is for me
very bitter and a tough decision which we MPs, and particularly we Greens, never take lightly.
I see Germany's role in the world as
defending international law and human rights, and especially in a world where chaos is on the rise, being a voice of reason.
If I were Defense Secretary, the first thing I'd do is
lead a discussion about the priorities of the army in order to deploy them accordingly. The United Nations and European Union missions play a key role.
Agnieszka Brugger, many thanks.
My pleasure.